No one ever better tell me that Mrs. E.G. White was not inspired of God. I know too much about her personally. And I know what I saw with my own eyes 3 nights in succession. Amen. As the angel was helping her with her manuscript. When Eve and Adam sinned, God did not abandon the human race. Aren't you thankful?
Amen.
During the Old Testament times and before, God the Son used to appear to the patriarchs in disguise. Because sinners cannot abide the presence of deity. He appeared sometimes in the appearance of a man, sometimes as the angel in whose name is Jehovah. In your King James Version, where you see the word Lord all in capital letters, that's speaking of Christ in the Old Testament, Jehovah. He appeared to them as the I Am, the self-existent one. He was the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, others. Then angels assisted him in his ministry. And the mighty angel who took Lucifer's place, Gabriel, became the angel of prophecy. He was the one, you remember, who appeared to Daniel and other prophets in the Old Testament. Many people, other than Seventh-day Adventists, realize that the gift of prophecy was just as prominent in the New Testament as it was in the Old Testament. It was the second in the list of spiritual gifts that Christ put in his church. Now, with all due respect to men and women of giant intellect, as well as earnest Christians in the great churches, why is it that in the great denominations, the present time, we have over 1,000 religious organizations filed with our federal government so they won't have to pay taxes? And when we think of all these great denominations and the proliferation of sects professing Christianity, why are they not all teaching the same truth? Why are they not all teaching the same doctrines? Something is lacking. John envisioned, beloved John, disciple whom Jesus loved. God is no respecter of persons, but love begets love. And there, when he was an old man, suffering persecution under Rome, he saw in vision a beautiful woman, a pure woman, clothed with the light of the gospel represented by the sun, standing on the moon, the reflection of the work of Christ, our high priest, in the sanctuary. And as he looked at that woman, he saw on her head a crown of 12 stars, representing the 12 apostles. And she was about to give birth to a man-child, whom the dragon standing before her was about to destroy as soon as he was born. And remember, that was fulfilled through Herod, who had all the babies and male babies in Bethlehem slain. And that child was to be caught up to God and to his throne. He saw that woman persecuted especially for 1260 years, and then he saw something else. He saw the descendants, not only God the Son, to whom the Old Testament church gave birth. Mary didn't belong to the New Testament. Some people overlook that. The woman that he saw was this true church of all ages. And he saw the closing scenes of Earth's history. He saw the seed, the descendants of that woman. What was left? The remnant of the seed. And they were the people, just as God's people had been in all ages, who did not lose out in the falling away that came in the Christian church. They kept God's commandments, just as Jesus and his apostles did. But they had something. They had something that the rest of the world did not have. And you know what it is, or you would not be here this morning. They kept God's commandments and had what? A testimony of Jesus Christ, and that's the spirit of prophecy. Now, if you study the first three verses of Revelation, it tells us how it operates. From the Father, the Son to the angel to the prophet. And in those verses, it tells you that the testimony of Jesus is also the Word of God. Even after it was written out for the church, it was still God's Word. It was the Word of the Father given to His Son. And then the Son took charge, and that's why it's called the testimony of Jesus. Now, in your own mind, bring back in your memory the work of the angel Gabriel as he appeared to Daniel. And think of the angel of prophecy all through the ages, working in very close connection with the Holy Spirit. The authors of the Bible, holy men of God, spake and wrote as they were moved out by the Holy Ghost. Some have thought erroneously that the Holy Ghost and Gabriel are the same person. That's not true. But they worked very, very closely together. Now, Mrs. E.G. White, who was just a little girl, Ellen Harmon, frail, humble, was picked out by the Lord after prominent men were afraid people would ridicule them if they carried out what God wanted them to do. She did not want to do it. She felt too humble. I knew her personally as a child, and many years later used to see her almost every day in California. And when I was just a baby in my baby carriage, she and my mother were pushing me in the baby carriage. Sister White stopped my mother and said, "Eddie, I've been shown that your baby is going to grow up to be an ordained Seventh-day Adventist minister." Offered a short prayer, placed her hand on that baby's head and dedicated the baby to the ministry. And he's with you today. As you have read Sister White's writings, especially the testimonies and special messages that she was given, you will have noticed over and over again that although at times Christ spoke to her personally, usually it was an angel. She often speaks of that, that the angel told her something or told her what to write, sometimes word by word. But other times, she was like prophets in the Old Testament who were called seers. You've read that. The ancient prophets were called seers because they saw something. They saw things in visions and dreams. And then an angel was sent to explain what they meant. And you'll remember that the captain of the Lord's host, God the Son, came and even assisted the angel of prophecy in making people understand. I used to wonder, as I was growing up, about the angel appearing to Mrs. E.G. White. 1911, I was working as surgical nurse in a hospital in St. Helena, California. Dr. Rand and Dr. Kligerman were the surgeons and often assisted them in the surgery. And for a time I was on special duty from 11 o'clock at night until 2 o'clock in the morning. And by 2 o'clock I was tired and anxious to get to bed. We had so many patients that year, they had hundreds of tents all over the mountain. And we nurses and workers had to find a place to sleep, any old place we could. I had a bedroom on the backside of a little cottage around that moon-shaped edge. By the way, how many have been in St. Helena and Elmshaven? Let me see the hands. I'm always glad when some people are present, they know what I'm talking about. Well, from the old sanitarium building, you go around that, we called it the Hog's Back. Halfway around was the hospital at that time. And way around at the end, down a little bit, I had a room, my backside of that cottage. I could look right over the top of the church school and see Sister White's bedroom, the window on the left, her writing room on the right. Now, my tiny little sister was a playmate of Grace, who was Sister White's little granddaughter. And Elder Arthur White, who was now an old man, I had a nice visit with him the other day, Washington, D.C. He was just a little boy, about like that then. I loved all of them. But because of that, I knew her bedroom was on the left, her writing room on the right. I got back to my room one night, turned the electric light on, and started to undress. When I jumped, what do you suppose made me jump? It was a dark night, and I had my light on and was undressing. How would you feel if you were undressing if your light got as light as noonday all at once? You wonder I jumped? I wondered where that light was coming from. It was the most beautiful light. I have not any words to express it. It was nothing that man had made. And when that light came on, I whirled around to see where it was coming from. And it was coming from Sister White's writing room. And that light in that room was so bright at that distance, I could see everything as clearly as I can see you people right here in front of me. And someone was standing there, not facing me. The person standing there was looking toward the door of the writing room. And I could see half of the person's back and the side, but I couldn't see any features. And whoever that was not wearing clothes like we do. That person was clothed with that beautiful, beautiful light. I was astounded, and I watched very closely, and as I watched, here I saw Sister White's bed. Well, how in the world could I see her bed through the window to her writing room when the room on the other side was her bedroom? That puzzled me. Well, it was some years afterward when I was reading some accounts of Sister White's life, private matter, that problem was solved. She was so feeble that they moved her bed from her bedroom around to the entrance to her writing room. So I was not seeing errors. I was seeing the truth, things just as they were. I saw that dear old saint of God get up out of bed and throw something over her shoulders, looked like a bedroom robe or dressing robe, and went to her chair. That was that comfortable chair. They had taken the legs off of a little sewing table and hinged it to her chair. She went and sat down in that chair and turned that thing over and took her pencil, and she'd look up at that person and then write. And look up. I couldn't hear anything, but somebody was talking to her. I could see that, you see. She'd look up, write some more, look up, write some more, and the light went out. Well, the next night, I just started to undress, same thing all over again. I watched very closely. And the third night, the same thing again. The next morning, I went for a walk from the old sanitarium building down that steep hill toward Elmshaven, and halfway down there, I met Herbert and Henry coming up the hill. One of our brethren this morning told me he learned his printer's trade from one of the twins. Sister White's twin grandsons, Herbert and Henry, they were about 16 years old at that time. They had a little print shop up at the sanitarium where they had a job press. PUC and St. Helena and so on furnished them a lot of the job, but they took private jobs too. Well, we stopped and visited a little bit because I thought so much of those boys, and then I said, "Boys, what is your grandma doing at the present time? Nice." Well, they shrugged their shoulders, and one of them said, "Well, I hope grandma's sleeping." So we went on visiting then. I didn't tell them why I asked. And pretty soon one of them said, "Well, Mr. Williams, I remember something now. The other morning, we were late. And we were expecting some customers at the print shop, and we were eating just as fast as we could eat, not paying attention to what was going on around us, when all at once I noticed that Grandma leaned over and said something to Daddy." So he said, I stopped and listened, and I heard Grandma tell Daddy that the angel Gabriel was helping her with manuscript. Manuscript? Yeah. What manuscript? A book. Well, what's the book going to be? Acts of the Apostles. I said, "Will you boys try to get me the first one off the press?" Well, they said they'd try. I don't know whether I got the first one or not, but a few months later, after the book was out and printed, they brought me one they said was the first, and whether it was or not, I cherish that book very, very much. Now, if you will look in your copy of Acts of the Apostles, you will see that it was copyrighted in 1911. And that same time, 1911, great controversy was being revised, not because of anything that Sister White had seen and visioned in it. I wish I could tell you a lot of those things. I'd like, Elder, I wish I could have at least 3 full hours to talk with you about these things. But in any book that is written, you pick up any of our denominational books, and there will be things in there and dates to be given, and a few years they're out of date and they need to be brought up to date. Well, that's what was going on the same year, 1911. Now, whether the angel was helping Sister White with her final checkup on Acts of the Apostles, or whether it was on great controversy, or both of them, I do not know. But both of those books have meant a great deal more to me. None of her writings are so precious to me as Great Controversy. No other book that I've ever read in my life has drawn me so close to Jesus outside of the Bible. It's Desire of Ages. What a wonderful book that is.
And there's some questions that invariably come up. So I'm going to share some of them with you right now. Question one. Someone says, I cannot understand how you could see into Sister White's windows from a house on that upper road. It is too far away. Answer. That upper road was not in existence in 1911 when I lived there. It was built since then. A little cottage where I slept on the enclosed back porch was at the end of a path way below the hospital and around the curve, so I could see the roof of the church school, and to the right of that from my position, I could see the upper windows of Elmshaven. The only road at that time from the sanitarium to the little city of St. Helena ran down the steep hill from the sanitarium and past close to Elmshaven. Question two. How do you know the person you saw helping Sister White was not a member of her working staff or of her household? Answer. I know that for several reasons. First, surely no member of the family or of her staff would get her up after 2 o'clock in the morning to help her with her work. Second, the person I saw was taller, was larger than human beings. Third, his person was clothed not with garments like human beings wear, but with that glorious, scintillating, unearthly light that lighted even my room. It was not a man-made light. And then fourth, before I told the twins anything about it, as I visited them the fourth morning, one of them told me that he heard his grandma tell his daddy that the angel Gabriel had been helping her nights with her manuscript. And I asked what manuscript, and they said Acts of the Apostles. Question three. Why could you not see that person's features? Answer. Because he was facing Sister White, so that I could only see part of his back and side. I could see the silhouette, the form of his whole person, but could not see the features because he was facing toward Sister White. Question four. You said that the person you saw was larger than human. How could so large a person get in and out of that room? Answer. I do not know. I believe that angels are mighty beings, and in their natural state couldn't even stand up in one of our rooms. They are not cumbered with human flesh and bone made from elements of earth like we are. That is something I hope you and I will learn after we leave this world. There's many things that I'm looking forward to learn about in the future life. Question five. Could what you saw have been a dream? Or could an evil spirit have appeared as an angel? Answer. I was very much awake, having just come off duty in the hospital. I was just undressing to go to bed and had my electric light on when my room was suddenly lighted up like daylight. And that happened 3 nights in succession. I was just as wide awake as I am this minute. Now, it was no dream or imagination. I shall answer the second part of your question with a question to you. would Satan or any evil spirit help Mrs. White compose a book like Acts of the Apostles? You know they would not.
What I saw Sister White's writing room, I did not see a light in her window. I hope you get that straight.
Yes.
Some people have asked me at different times if I saw a light in Sister White's window. No. That light lightened my room up. Even when I had my electric light on, it lightened my room up as light as the brightest noonday. And I saw a person standing in her room, and I saw everything clear and visibly in her room. I saw that person standing there clothed in that light instead of clothes like you and I wear. Don't go from here and say that Elder William saw a light in Sister White's window. He did not. He saw a being dictating to her as she took notes. And he was clothed with that light that lightened my room up as bright as noonday. My first reaction was a shock. To think that something lightened up my room lighter than noonday when I had my electric light on. My electric light was nothing. I was shocked. I turned to see where it was coming from, and when I saw it inside Sister White's room, not a light in her window, when I saw it inside her writing room, and that being clothed with that light, I felt very, very small and insignificant. Not ashamed of myself, but thankful. Thankful to God that I saw with my own eyes something that nobody could ever shake my faith in. And I still feel that way. There was an old friend of mine. He used to work with my wife's brother. We knew him well. He lived there at Pacific Union College. I mean at St. Helena Sanitarium. And he told me that he had seen that light at different times. I only saw it those three nights in succession. And saw that person standing there clothed with that glorious light. Three nights. What kind of a woman was Sister White? Until middle age, old age set in, she was very thin, very frail, weak. She was only a little over 5 feet tall, just a little lady, very humble. She never put on airs. Sweet disposition. She loved the children. She loved the people. And the children loved her. Never self-important. Maybe you have a darker society here. Do you? May have a different name. You take second-hand clothes and fix them up nice and give them to the poor. That's a good work. But if Sister White saw a lady who needed a dress, poor family, do you suppose she'd give her one of hers that she'd use? No. If the woman needed a dress and she couldn't sew, Sister White would buy the goods and make her a dress, make her a present of it. That was the kind of darkest work that she did. She was approachable. Anyone could approach her. She'd be glad to talk heart to heart with people. But what broke her own heart was to have to give messages to people who were in sin. Have to go and tell them their faults. That hurt her. But it was always with love. Elder White has just brought out his biography of Sister White, between and including the years 1900 1905. I remember well going through those years, the years of the great Alpha apostasy that nearly wrecked our church. And I hope you'll get that book for your family and read it and see how God's servants pleaded with different ones. She was not a hand to condemn. She'd plead with them to the very end. And if you will read the copies of her letters that she sent to Dr. J.H. Kellogg and see how she labored and pleaded with that man to the very end and tried to spare his feelings. I knew Canwright. I knew A.T. Jones. I knew Dr. J.H. Kellogg. I knew nearly all of our Adventist ministers and doctors when I was a boy. And I was old enough to and did understand what was going on in the Alpha apostasy, pantheism, and what nearly wrecked our church. And through most of my 92 years, I have watched and have taken part in this Advent movement. And from time to time, from those days to this, I have seen bright lights go out, fall off the path. And I've watched the reason for it. Would you like to know some of the reasons that I have noticed? Those bright lights, one of the things that ruined them first, they began to admire their own light. And like selfish, spoiled little children, of course that's not like our little boys and girls, but you know these spoiled little brats, if they can't be it, they won't play. Well, that was the trouble with some who went out from us. They wanted to be it. Some of them even wanted to be president of the General Conference, and because they weren't elected, they got beat. Too much I. One of Theodore Roosevelt's said about his father, it just comes to my mind right now. He said the trouble with Dad was he wanted to be the bride at the wedding and the corpse at the funeral. I wanted to be it. That has been the trouble with those who have gone out from us. And the reason they have fought against the testimonies to the church and the writings of the Spirit of Prophecy in every instance, it's been because something in their life was touched. And they were not humble enough to take counsel. They rebelled. They became angry. And they got so they had to scratch their head way out here. And that's right up to the present time. And I mean that. God wants humble men and women, and he wants to use humble little boys and girls, not proud people. One of the remarkable things of her ministry was that if in vision, thousands of miles away, she saw someone erring, a soul in danger, she'd send a telegram and it would get there just on the dot. Just in time to save the situation. A.T. Jones, whom I knew, he was a very close friend of my father and mother. He'd been president of the California Conference, been made quite a mess of things different times. But she pleaded with that man and tried so to help him. And after Dr. Kellogg had gone out completely and was out of the church, he sent word to Elder Jones that if he'd come back and teach in the Battle Creek College, which Kellogg had stolen from the denomination, He wanted him as a teacher. And he preached a sermon in the 29th Street Church in Oakland. My wife and I used to be members of that church. And the old members have told me of what happened. Elder Jones got up there and he was telling the people that at the close of that service, he was going to take a train, he was going to go to Battle Creek, and he knew positively that he could have Dr. Kellogg back in the church in just a few weeks. He knew he could do it. They were such good friends, and he was boasting and boasting about what he was going to do when a messenger came from a telegraph office. Sister White was in California, but not near him. He didn't even know where he was. Instead of reading the telegram first to himself, he read it out loud before the whole church. And the telegram told Elder Jones that unless he humbled himself and took that train and went to Battle Creek instead of converting and bringing Dr. Kellogg back in, that he would fall under the power of hypnotism and would be out of the church himself in a few weeks. And he haw-haw-haw-hawed right out in church, making fun of it. He said he used to believe in the inspiration of Mrs. E.G. White, but God never told her that. Nothing could ever take him out of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Well, he went, and what happened? That man who used to hold thousands of people spellbound with his silvery-tongued orator, I saw him beside of the road with a chart hung from the bushes of a tree, and he couldn't get three people to stop to listen to him. The Holy Spirit had left him. Pitiful. Pitiful how bright lights will go out. As I told you this morning, in every instance that I have watched clear down to the present time, it was because self got in the way. Depending on self and the world's teaching that brings doubt. God can use humble people. How humble was he? How humble was Jesus? Died as a criminal on a cross. That's the sort of thing that they did to God's prophets clear down through the ages, and even to God's own Son, crucified. And just as sure as you give your life to the Lord, and all that you are, you're going to have trouble. As a young man, I was in public school work, a supervisor of education with a splendid salary and a bright future. I went into the ministry for $15 a week and no subsidies and plenty of troubles. Splendid position in a big city and not one second of unpleasantness. But when I got into the ministry, I met plenty of things that were not pleasant. I would say to any young man, do not enter the ministry if you can keep out of it. If God's calling you into the ministry, you'll get there. If he's not calling you, you better not be there. He wants humble boys and girls, humble men and women, humble youths who are willing to lay aside all that they have and work for him. I seldom speak of this, but I know what it means. I wish I might live until Jesus comes. But if not, I know I'll not be here much longer at my age. But at one time, I was sole heir to an estate of more than $60 million. Risked my own life and went through a terrible life, a terrible testing time, to save the life of the wealthiest man west of the Rocky Mountains. I could tell you more about him, a man that was known worldwide. That's enough. And after I turned my back on that, I nearly starved to death for a while. Then the Lord took care of me. He may take you through a time of stress to make you know that you're sure what you're doing. I was walking down a street in Oakland. I hadn't had anything to eat for several days. I was broken out with carbuncles. I couldn't stand on my head, lie down, stand up, or get any position that I wasn't on carbuncles. I didn't have the money to go to a doctor. I had 1 5-cent piece that would take me to a certain address, and all I would have to do would be to walk in. And I'd be reinstated without saying a word. Here was a peanut vendor coming. And I took that 5-cent piece out and I looked at it. You see, I hadn't burned the last bridge. That 5 cents would take me on a trolley over to Berkeley. I burned the last bridge. I spent that nickel for 5 cents worth of peanuts. I went back on the walk. I was on the edge of the city. I didn't know anyone was anywhere near me. And I raised my hand and I said, "Dear Heavenly Father, I only want to live to serve you. And if I drop dead in my tracks, I'm not going to back up." And instantly a hand was laid on my shoulder. And a man turned me around and said, "Young man, I heard that prayer." And he asked me if there was a certain thing that I could do. And I said, "Yes, I'm an expert at it." He pulled out $100 and handed it to me. He said, "Go and start it. The Lord may take us to the end of the rope, but if that's the case, tie a knot in the end of the rope and hang on. God will take care of us. What He wants is people of faith, but humble people." Oh, friends, don't give up your faith. God has called us as a people, the remnant of the seed of the woman of light, the people who keep God's commandments and have the testimony of Jesus, which is the spirit of prophecy. God bless you each. Well, one of the brethren in the General Conference the other day asked me what I could attribute my length of days to, and I said, "By minding my own business." But I know there's something more than that. About 40 years ago, I was taken ill, went to a specialist, and he said, "You're a minister?" "Yes." "Then you want the truth?" "Yes." "Well, you have less than 48 hours to live. So whatever you do, get at it in a hurry." 40 years ago, still I'm here with you. God must have something still for me to do. I had a terrible cancer in the abdomen. Had major surgery 12 times. The last time was about 18 years ago. Here I'm going and feeling pretty good. God didn't see fit to heal it up instantly. I guess He wanted to give me a lesson in patience. That's all I can think of that it could mean. But in 1940, there was a butane explosion I was operating with a few others, a self-supporting school for our underprivileged young people, and a small hospital. Butane explosion and fire ended everything to ashes in less than 20 minutes. One of my sons and I nearly burned to death, and the doctors told my wife and others that there was no hope, absolutely no hope. My lungs were burned out, so I couldn't live. They couldn't give me new lungs. And even if I did live, I would never have any eyes. I would never have any ears or nose or chin. I would never have any hands. You see what I have. God did it. Surgeons did it. They did not. And three doctors who were atheists said the experience made Christians out of them. That being true, even with all the suffering and agony and losing everything I had in the world, even the clothes burned off of me, I couldn't have come out of the hospital unless somebody had loaned me a barrel or some clothes or something. I didn't have anything. But when doctors told me afterward that they had never believed in a God before, but now they were Christians, that was worth it all and so much more. Oh, I love God, our Heavenly Father, and Jesus who died and suffered so much for us. Brethren, friends, have faith. The last time she ever spoke was at Pacific Union College. That was just in the early years of Pacific Union College. Well, the Sabbath school was over, and the place we were meeting was the old dance hall. And they were trying to change it over for a summer resort into a college. And we'd had our intermission, and we sang the first hymn for the worship hour, and had the prayer, and then the double doors opened. You see, that had been used for a dance hall and a theater, and it was a big stage. And W.C. White, Willie White, her son, and Elder Washburn, the history teacher, and Elder Irwin, the president, carried her in bodily because she could not walk. She was frail and weak. And after she'd rested a little bit, they helped her to the pulpit. And I was sitting like this, so I looked right up into her face. We had folding chairs, and the place was packed. And she prayed a humble prayer, as she always did. She never put on airs, big words praying. And when she said amen, her face lighted up, made me think of one of these paper Japanese lanterns when you light a candle in it. And she told the brethren that she didn't need their help anymore. Something about the Holy Spirit, I forget the exact words. From that time on, she didn't even have to touch the pulpit, didn't need the man's help, and you would have thought she was a middle-aged woman for the vitality she seemed to have. And she talked for a long time. And when she offered a prayer at the close, that light went out of her face and she would have fallen flat. But the brethren had to catch her and carry her out. That was the last time she ever spoke in public. And I told you some of the things that she said in that time. Message to our young people.
Yes, I take it for granted from what I've read and from what you said that A.T. Jones did leave the message. Also, E.J. Wagoner. Now, the 1888 Minneapolis Conference, at that time the Lord, in His great mercy, sent a most precious message to these two young men, Christ Our Righteousness, written by E.J. Wagoner, and A.T. Jones, The Consecrated Way to Christian Perfection. I have been teaching for 43 years in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and I have found that I cannot influence our people at any time to read anything written by these two consecrated men before they left the church. I want to I would like to have it verified that what they wrote shortly after the Minneapolis conference is strictly authentic and ought to be read and followed because they teach the sanctuary truth as it is in Jesus Christ. And you are one man that can verify the truth of that statement.
The Lord uses all kinds of people. You remember the experience of Balaam? He has used some people against even their own will. And there was a time when God used those two men wonderfully. But they got to the time when they admired themselves too much. What I've been telling you these three times. And they went too far against all pleading and admonition. And finally stepped off the path. Even in our own church history, let me give you an example. You will pick up book after book of the history of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and it will tell you that Seventh-day Adventists got the Sabbath from the Seventh-day Baptists through Rachel Preston. There were people in New Bedford and Dartmouth keeping the Sabbath before Rachel Preston ever went up there. But that got into our history books. Men hadn't heard about that, you see. They wrote what they knew. Okay? But some people who are nitpickers and want to find fault with Sister White's writings, you can find it. You can do the same thing with the Bible. You see, Sister White only had as much formal education as our children would get up to the end of about the third grade. And yet she wrote on subjects of health and medicine and so on. The medical profession is just now finding out the last few years. And she did not get that from her secretaries. Because they didn't know it. The doctors didn't know it until our day. I'm going to say it again. From my personal experience of the Lord's messenger, I do not think she was inspired. I know she was inspired. No one can shake my faith. If you're acquainted with your Bible at all, I doubt if you can find the record of one of God's prophets that didn't have a lot of opposition. Do you ever stop to think of that? They were persecuted. The greatest of them all had his head chopped off. And as we were riding here to the service this afternoon, a thought came to me. Wherever you go, you will find people like the old fellow who heard some people talking and he said, well, I don't know what it was all about, but whatever it was, I'm agin it. Some people are like that. Now, these soul-hire critics who accept evolution instead of the Bible and find a lot of fault with the Bible, and you can find a lot of fault with it if you try. There comes to my mind right now an experience that happened. You'll not find this in any of our books. Some of the things that I tell, many things are not in our books that took place. Sister White had over 2,000 visions and dreams. Many things that happened in her life, like the life of anyone, you'll not find in books. Elder G.B. Starr and his wife were with Sister White for 18 years over in Australia and other places. And Elder Starr told me this a number of times, and he told it in churches where I was pastor. And he always told it the same, too. After Sister White went to Australia and our school was founded there in Avondale, she went to the cook one day and said, now, I don't want any more tea or coffee. I don't want any more flesh foods. I want a good variety of vegetables and fruits and told to cook what she wanted, and don't say anything to anyone. That was characteristic of Sister White. She taught by example more than by word. By the way, Sister White was a great meat eater one time, and she liked her pork. Oh, I could tell you so many things. I mustn't get off the track. But after she was following her diet without any comment at all, there in the dining room, different people at her table saw her food, and it seemed to do her so much good. They said, well, can't we have food like you have? Sure, be all right. And then different tables, they asked if they couldn't have food like that table. And it spread clear through the school. But one table. Now, you told how many churches I've been pastor in. If that seemed like a big story, remember that we used to have 6 and 8 churches in the district. Those count up fast. But this has been my experience. Whether it is churches or lodges or any kind of gathering of people, in almost every group of people, you will find a little knot of troublemakers. Of course, you wouldn't have that in this church. But that is characteristic. It's humanity for you. And everybody there in the dining room at Avondale were following what today we call a vegetarian diet. Ovo-lacto vegetarian. And they would make fun. And at that table, in that group, were some of the faculty members too. Mind you, faculty members. They were poo-hooing and making fun. Now today, you go among people that are educated and people who never even heard of such a thing as a Seventh-day Adventist, and they'll tell you that's the right kind of diet. That's what doctors will tell you. Sister White had been writing on her manuscript for great controversy. And she longed to see where those persecutions took place over in the Alps. She wanted to get the feeling of it. It's one thing to see something. It's a different thing than just hearing about it. So she went over to the Alps, where those people were hunted down like wild beasts. From there, they went to London. And there she was writing on her manuscript one day, right in broad daylight, in the large living room of an Adventist family, and the angel appeared right by her side. And the angel said, watch, had something draped over his arm. He went to the corner of the room and gave a stab like that, didn't have to have a hammer or a screwdriver, said, watch. He went across to the other corner and gave a stab, and there was a curtain that unfolded. And he said, now listen. She listened, and here was that little group of people. Now, mind you, she was in London, and she heard the voices of the people at that dining table clear over in Australia, half the world away. And he said, now watch. And he opened the curtain, and the other side of the room, instead of what it had been, was the corner of the room clear over in Australia. God had his television a long while before we did. And there she saw those people and heard every word. And he said, look at the clock. She looked at the clock. He said, write down the time. Now he said, write a letter to those people and tell them how they sat at the table, describe the whole thing, and what they said. Folded up the curtain, disappeared. I'm glad I were not in those people's shoes. How they must have felt to find out that she had seen and heard the whole thing thousands of miles away. Man has invented wonderful, wonderful things, but they still cannot come up to God's original. His TV and his radio. I've had some things come to me that about broke my heart. A few years ago, I hope I'm doing right in telling this, but I feel impressed to do it. I sent a number of young people to one of our major colleges. One was a bright young lady, brilliant. She had finished high school and wanted to prepare her life for the Lord's work. And as I talked with her, she decided to prepare to be a Bible worker. I wish we had more Bible workers today. Our Bible workers used to bring in more converts than most of our preachers. That's something that's been neglected. Now, a friend of mine that I had known for many years, who had been a missionary in India, came back to the States. He had taught Bible in every one of our senior colleges. He really knew his Bible and was a man of God. Going back a bit, Sister White had urged our leaders over, over and over again to pick out certain men who were thoroughly grounded in the truth and to send them to these great worldly colleges to get their degrees, because the time would come when it would be necessary, and they put it off and put it off and put it off until the crisis came in Loma Linda and we were forced to that sort of thing. Now we've gone overboard the other way. Well, that man who had taught in all our major major colleges at that time was dropped, eased out, because he did not have the accreditation in theology that the world, which is turning out highly skilled barbarians, demands. And a man was put in his place who has what accrediting requires. That young lady came back in less than a week, crying her eyes out day and night. She couldn't pray. She wanted to pray. She couldn't pray. She wouldn't attend family worship. She wouldn't go to Sabbath school. She wouldn't go to church. I finally found out from her and other students that I had sent in the very first class that that man, with his degrees in theology, closed the door, locked it, and told his students that he wanted to talk with them confidentially. And he went on to tell about those pioneers back there. They were good Christian people. They meant well. But now we're living in an enlightened age. And he said that something that I want you to get through your heads right now in this first class. God is not a person. And then he wiggled his ear and said, imagine God having an ear. Imagine God hearing our prayers. Well, that's just one of many things I could tell you. I believe in higher education and all with all my heart. And I'm so thankful that we have our institutions. But we're living in a dangerous time. And when people will spend years just for accreditation so they can stand high, it's a miracle if they come back to our institutions without having some of this lack of faith rubbing off on their own souls. And that sort of thing started way back about 1913, along in there. several of our ministers who went and got their degrees dropped out of the ministry. And that sort of thing creeping in, we're getting the fruit of it right now. Men with their degrees going out, they know more than the spirit of prophecy. They know almost more than the Bible. The Bible doesn't mean how it says, with their higher learning, does away with the sanctuary, with much of Christ's priesthood, and so on. If there was ever a time in the history of this world that God's people needed the guidance of the Holy Spirit and a personal spirit of humility, it is right now. It is not degrees of scholastic worldly education that's going to get us through to heaven. It's going to be faith. Jesus said, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? He will find faith on the earth. He will find the people who are keeping the commandments of God and who have something that the world does not have. And we know what that is.
I think we have just enough time for one other personal experience, not directly with Sister White, but it bears on it. I think y'all know about it. Because of sickness, I had missed a year's work in school, and being busy in medical work, I'd never made up those subjects. And when my wife and I were nurses in Oakland, in the Bay Cities, 1912, I wanted to make up those subjects. So I went to the principal of the Chauncey Fremont High School in Melrose. Melrose is now way inside the city of Oakland. It was a separate city at that time. And I enrolled in a class of advanced English, which I had missed. And when I talked with the teacher, Miss E. McMillan, she agreed with me. I was looking forward to becoming a medical missionary, an ordained minister. And when I told her that I didn't want to waste a lot of time with a lot of filth, she agreed with me. She said, when the class is reading and enacting a lot of that stuff from Shakespeare and Chaucer, you don't have to listen to that. She said, I'll bring books from the university, Berkeley, that's where she lived, and assign you extra reading in that. And while they're going through all that trash, you can have my private office, and then I'll call you out when you're needed. When it came to the close of the year, Miss McMillan announced that she was going to give an oral test to the class. She was going to have some students read a quotation from their favorite author. And then, from the style of the language, they were to tell who the author was. Well, that'd be an interesting test, wouldn't it? There were only, well, she said she was going to pick out three who had never had any grades below 95%. And it so happened that your speaker was one of them. And the next morning, she called on me first. And who do you suppose the author was that I quoted? Yes. I gave a quotation from the pen of Mrs. E.G. White and took it from Desire of Ages. And she said, now, class, who was the author? Just one hand went up. The brightest member of the class, beautiful young woman. And she said, well, Miss McMillan, I'm just not positive. There's something about this that seems inspired. She said the style of the language is very much like that of General Lew Wallace, who wrote Ben-Hur. How many of you have ever read that, Ben-Hur? Oh, yes, some of you. It's a beautiful book. And it is a fact that the style of his authorship is much like that of Mrs. E.G. White. Well, Miss McMillan said it was not General Lew Wallace. It was from a lady by the name of Mrs. E.G. White. She said, "No, I don't know anything about the religion of Mrs. E.G. White. I've never been to the church that she attends. I don't know anything about her religion." But then she went on in a humble way to tell us of the degrees that she had in English, not only in the United States, but in Europe. And she simply told that the class would know she knew what she was talking about. She said, "Now open your notebooks." We had special notebooks in that class. "And I want you to write down, every one of you, write down in that book what I'm going to tell you." And this is what she had us write. "Of all literature written, ancient, medieval, and modern, the most perfect and the most beautiful, aside from the Bible itself, is the writings of Mrs. E.G. White." She was not an Adventist or connected with any Adventist. And yet she recognized, and that young lady recognized, that there was something more than beauty. They felt that it was inspired. No one ever better tell me that Mrs. E.G. White was not inspired of God. I know too much about her personally, and I know what I saw with my own eyes 3 nights in succession.
Amen.
As the angel was helping her with her manuscript.